film, Sagari Ghosh is a well-known journalist and also a broadcaster, educated at St. Stephen's in Oxford. She started her career with Times of India and worked at Outlook magazine and the Indian Express. Later, she joined the IBN network and was prime anchor at CNN and IBN until recently. She is currently a consulting editor at Times of India and is the author of two novels. Priya Ramani has been a journalist and editor for 20 years, and until recently, she was editor of Mint Lounge, the popular weekend magazine of the financial newspaper Mint. She also stinted as a rookie reporter for the Asian Age, was a stock market reporter for Reuters, deputy editor of Elle, and editor of Cosmopolitan. She was editor of I and has worked in India Today, and she's currently taking time off to enjoy her baby, Baby John. A little about me. I worked for 20 years with Newsweek magazine in New York as a correspondent and United Nations Bureau Chief. I have interviewed about 50 heads of state around the world and finished a biography of Ramesh Chauhan, chairman of the Biscayan Bubbling Group. Till I retired to Goa, I have only worked within, operated within a US environment as a journalist. So I think I'm accustomed to a different system altogether. For example, a complete support system in case studies, from librarians who did our basic research, clippers who cut out necessary materials that we needed, a travel agency which took care of all our needs, editors who helped us figure out the angles, etc. My impression of the Indian journalist was formed in the mid-70s when I came to India to interview Mrs. Gandhi and then move on to Pakistan to meet Mr. Bhutto. I distinctly recall that after those interviews ran, the Mumbai Daily asked me to give them an interview about myself. They came to the venue about a half hour late, and they began the interview by saying, "We know nothing about you, so can you please tell us something about yourself?" I believe Indian journalism has come a long way since. I'm impressed by so many professionals in the media and delighted to see a number of women on board. But I wonder, Priya and Sagarika, what problems do you face that the public is not aware of? And I would like to know if it is difficult to break the male stranglehold on the profession. So basically, I want to know what our two guests feel about how difficult it is to break the male stranglehold on this profession.
Good morning, everyone. It's great to be here and lovely to see you all. I think we're discussing a very important issue today, which is women in media. There is a media explosion in India at the moment, social media, broadcast media, print media, and the media scene is extremely vibrant. But I think what does tend to happen in the media is that the men do tend to dominate as you go higher and higher up the hierarchy. I think this is possibly because of the way the media itself is structured. I'll tell you, I'll begin with a story that happened to me when I joined journalism 25 years ago now. I joined in the Times of India, and I was fresh out of university, and I was in the reporting desk. And the chief reporter there, who was a very veteran and seasoned journalist, looked at me and the other recruit, who was also a male, and said, you know, Mr. Ranjan, that was his name, you're here and we want you to take a role in the reporting team, and why don't you go out, and this is a story you have to do, there is a political rally, go out there and come back with your report, I want to see what you make of it. And he turned to me and said that, you are also here. So I said, yes, yes, I too have joined. He said, why don't you look around the office and see how it is, because it's a very hot day today. So, you know, you don't have to go out if you don't want to, just be here. And that was my first initiation into how the stereotypes actually work. And they're very, very insidious. You have to kind of prove yourself again and again, repeatedly, You have to, I think, be a little crazy. You know, you have to adopt a certain designer insanity. So people think she's mad, and therefore, perhaps not that kind of a woman. She's crazy. Send her everywhere because she's a little bit off. You know, she's a mad woman. And so I think it helps to be a little crazy and off and mad, because that kind of becomes your ally. Your lunacy becomes a certain ally in expressing yourself. But as you climb the ladder, you find that it's the men who tend to dominate as the editors and the news managers and the news organizers. And I think that tends to happen in India because politics is so male dominated. And in Indian journalism, if you're a political reporter, then you're a serious reporter. If you're reporting on health or on education or on gender justice, you're a soft feature woman, sweet person who needs to, you know, do sweet little soft things. If you're a political reporter, you are a real journalist and you're doing real reporting. And political journalism tends to be dominated by men because politics is male dominated. So Indian politics, as you know, is highly feudal, highly patriarchal, extremely dominated by men, and who actually see women reporters as oddities. Or when I started off, I was seen as very much an oddity, as a mad oddity, but as an oddity. And even though there were other very senior women journalists around, but they tended to sort of operate within a kind of zanana darbar, within a sort of ladies' compartment. Whereas if you wanted to really report on the political machinations, or you wanted to go traveling with politicians, or you wanted to do hard interviews with politicians, then you were seen as somehow intruding into a male domain, into a male club where you were this strange oddity. So because politics is deeply male dominated and deeply patriarchal, I think women journalists find it very difficult to penetrate the political realm in which male journalists operate. And male journalists find it therefore much easier to operate with the male politicians, to have informal networks with them, to sit around with them, develop their relationships with them, develop alliances with them, develop access to them, develop links with them that are border on friendship, but a woman journalist simply cannot have. We can do it with the female journalist, with the women politicians and the women political activists, but then again that puts you in a kind of ladies compartment. And that's my theory actually as to why women politicians in India are as mad as they are, because you know you have to be that a little bit crazy just to survive. Because it is so patriarchal, and politics is so viciously patriarchal that for a Mamata Banerjee or for a Jayalalitha or for a Mayawati, you can just see why their personas are as odd as they are, or as extraordinary as they are. It's precisely because they have to survive in an incredibly hostile environment. And I think that probably explains why they are the way they are. And I think as far as women journalists are concerned, that tends to happen as well. You have to develop the crazy persona to survive. You're also, in a sense, as Priya and I were discussing, if you are a certain way, if you dress a certain way, or you talk a certain way, within the newsroom itself, you're seen as westernized. A westernized woman in an Indian newsroom until even 10 years ago was public enemy number one. I mean, you're simply not taken seriously. You have to play down your gender, you have to play down your education, you have to play down your class, you have to play down where you come from. So a whole range of stereotypes are actually up against you if you are the so-called westernized educated woman in an Indian newsroom. So you have to work very hard to dispel those stereotypes. But I think the battle is being won because there are so many women journalists out there now, and they're challenging all these stereotypes, but we still have a long way to go.
I actually
actually, I took just to take that point about politicians one step further. You know, owners who own newspapers, and now they look for editors who are deal makers, you know, who can sort of negotiate newsprint rates and who can get the government to reduce excise duties on newsprint or whatever. So when that is a qualification for a job, obviously your contacts with politicians matter much more. And in that sense, I think men win out in that point. And in the newsroom, I mean, being an editor is a really tough job. You have to, the daily deadlines, if you're on television, the deadlines are minute by minute. You know, you've got to be aggressive, you're screaming all the time, and you know, so the prejudices really come into play when you're a woman and when you're acting like a man. You know, everybody starts saying, oh, she's arrogant. Everyone's favorite word to describe an Indian woman with balls. But
yeah, you know, when I was anchoring, that's exactly the right point, because when I was anchoring my show on CNN IBN, and you know, TV anchoring is about being aggressive. You have to ask questions and you have to put people in the spot. And I would find many women actually being very hostile to me, because they would be like, why are you so aggressive? And why do you ask questions? And why do you talk so loudly? And you know, and there would be a lot of enmity and animosity that I would feel from women as well as men, because I think the aggressive, questioning woman is so unacceptable. And of course, the men can be as aggressive as they want and scream as much as they want and say the nation wants to know and you know, all of that. But if imagine a woman in a sari saying the nation wants to know, I mean, she'd probably be publicly stoned or something, you know.
You know, that reminds me, in the US, they told me I was a bit too soft-pedaled for them. They told me I had to be much more aggressive. So it's just the opposite. I would like to know if you have a problem with the salaries. Are the salaries on par with men, or do the men get much more?
I think the salaries are not on par. The men get much more, precisely because the men tend to get moved into managerial positions much sooner than the women do. The men will get moved into, say, a news manager, news executives, editors. The women, but Priya, I think, was one of the few exceptions of the woman actually becoming editor of a mainstream product. But there are very few like you.
I'm just trying to count the number of women who are leading any like daily publication, and I can only think of Malini at Hindu maybe, and Balka Dutt at NDTV, Sagarika at CNN until recently. Yeah. So you can, but this, it's a situation that exists around the world. I think. And it's a situation that exists across industry also. I mean, at entry level, in communication school, mass media school, there's more women than men. And then as you go up the ladder, the women, I think women also opt out. I don't think we can sort of blame it all on the patriarchy. Because it is a really tough job. And you know, I don't know if I want to be, I don't know if I want to be taking deadline calls every day for the rest of my life. You know, I'm like thinking, okay, I'm in my early 40s now, and do I want to be doing this 10 years from now? You know, do I want to be sort of... So I think a lot of women also opt out at after 20 years or whatever. They want to do something flexi time or... So...
Yeah, I think that's a very good point. Also, you know, for example, women shouldn't opt out of, you know, for example, writing on the areas that a number of women want to write on. Like, I was very interested in writing on education and on reporting on gender justice issues. And until very recently, those were just not considered serious issues. They were just considered frivolous issues and light issues. And what's education, you know, what's gender justice? Does it really concern us? It's only now that you know, issues of health and gender justice are being taken up. And so I think women should opt out of, you know, because a lot of women feel that, gosh, I have to get to covering the BJP, or I have to start covering the Congress, or I have to start covering the Hindi Belt parties, because otherwise nobody would take me seriously as a journalist. But I think that also women maybe need to change a little bit, because there's so much serious journalism now happening in areas that were earlier considered soft, or considered female, or considered stuff that men don't write about. You know, no decent, hardcore male journalist will write on health and, you know, primary school reforms. Whereas I was genuinely interested in writing on those issues, and I think that I think a lot of women need to stay the course and believe that, you know, if they want to write on certain issues, or certain issues are important to them, they should go ahead and write on those issues and not feel that they have to necessarily get to be the BJP beat reporter to be taken seriously.
What about pressures from the editors to have you alter copy or change point of view? Is there a lot of that?
No, I've never faced it ever in my career. I've always worked in jobs where they allowed me to do exactly what I wanted. But maybe it wasn't because I was not covering politics, so I guess that makes a huge difference. And I also want to add one point to the previous point we were discussing, that because the Indian media is in such crisis right now, in such flux, and we have to think of new models to ways to reinvent journalism, I think women are going to play a big role in that, you know, because that sort of politics business mode of covering the world is changing rapidly. So while I'm not advocating viral videos or, you know, the BuzzFeed mode of journalism, I do think women will have better ideas on how, what's next for journalism.
Well, I was an editor, and there was an instance where there was a huge amount of pressure on us. I think everybody knows about that.
That's what I was leading up.
Well, I think there are three dangers to the media at the moment, and one is I always say politicization, corporatization, sensationalization. These are the three dangers that exist for the media, particularly the corporate-owned media. And there are certainly limits placed on the autonomy of editors when the corporate ownerships decide to go a certain way. But I think to some extent, perhaps that tendency is to some extent lessened because of the sheer plethora of media that exists. You know, if you don't cover this particular story, somebody else will cover it, or social media will cover it. So there are limits to censorship, and there are limits to control, because simply because of the multifarious media platforms that exist, and the sheer multiplicity and depth of media platforms that exist. So therefore, I think censorship by itself in a particular platform will have limited impact. But this is not to say that there aren't pressures. There are huge pressures.
I wonder if anyone would like to ask some questions of our guests, of our distinguished guests. If so, please put up your hand and... Yes?
So how do you regard the editor? I mean, okay, you had your vernacular channel as well. In fact, plenty of them had Lokmat and IBN 7. Did you see a very clear distinction in the way English media treats the women journalists, and in the way that vernacular media?
It's a very good question. There's a huge difference.
I'm a former IBM 7 employee who left this grapple because of the way women were treated. How much do I ask
for? There's a huge difference. The Hindi world, I mean, I don't want to say this without sounding politically incorrect, but it's a highly feudal kind of setup. And you have to kind of be part of one circle of influence and another circle of influence. I think the English journalists tend to be in their own little bubble, in their own little public school educated little world. It's tough for the women in the vernacular press, much tougher. But there's a lot of challenge to it coming. A lot of young women journalists are there, people like you, I guess, who have challenged.
Left it.
Yeah, you left. But it is very hard. It is very, very hard for the vernacular press.
Even Priya, I'd like to ask, because you know, TV Today has the
English India Today, and then it has the Hindi India Today.
And did you see a difference in the way women are treated inside the office, within the vernacular media, or if you did have exposure to that at all?
I did have some exposure to it, and I mean, I think it's definitely tougher for them than it was for us. But I mean, there are lots of like amazing women in Hindi journalism also. Mrinal Pandey is my all-time favorite. You know, I mean, I think it doesn't matter to women, you know, beyond a point. You just have to keep pushing
in. Mrinal Pandey has a legacy. She's born of Shivani, and you know, it makes so much of a difference with your lineage.
Absolutely. No, journalism is a tough profession, especially if you're a woman. But it's also an amazingly easy profession, you know. It's sort of...
It is tough. It's very tough. Particularly if you're out there on reporting story, you know, in the field, it's very, very tough.
No doubt about it. You just have to have a hide like a rhino and just carry on regardless. But you know, as I say, make lunacy your ally. make madness your heuristic device, your weapon. So if people know that this one is a little bit crazy and she's a little bit off and pata nahi kya bol degi and कभी कभी ये भी करती है वो भी करती है यू नो देन दे थिंक अरे इससे दूर रहो यू नो सो देन यू हैव योर फ्रीडम एक्चुअली विद इन योर इंसैनिटी यू आर यूनिकली फ्री
आल्सो व्हेन यू से हाइड लाइक राइनो यू नो आई मीन आई थिंक दैट सॉर्ट ऑफ रिक्वायर्ड इवन मोर नाउडेज बिकॉज ऑफ सोशल मीडिया आई मीन प्रीवियसली We all wrote stories and, you know, never got any feedback, or we got some inland envelope letter from a reader, you know, whatever. But now there's instant feedback and instant abuse from unnamed, anonymous, unidentified women haters. You know?
Priya and I get it in the neck. I mean, both Priya and I actually are getting it in the neck night and day from these social media trolls. I mean, and a lot of it is, you know, and there's a difference between how we get abused and how the men get abused.
Absolutely. You know, I mean, there's like rape threats for your children, you know, I mean, and this is standard operating procedure. It's so common that we don't even think about it anymore, you know, but in the beginning, when one was first exposed to it, one was terrified and, you know, No, I didn't. Did you?
Yeah, I did. I got a threat of a
gang rape, that I would be gang raped and my daughter would be gang raped. She would be picked up from school at a particular point and taken. And they knew my daughter's school, so that's when I registered a police complaint. I think these are all empty threats.
Yeah.
But they're very, very disturbing. And as Priya said, when they happen for the first time, you're completely not... you just don't expect it at all. So you get incredibly taken aback, and I think it's vicious and it's relentless, and it's difficult to, you know, the more you respond to it, the more energized they seem to get. So there's a lot of misogyny and a lot of woman hatred. I think there's also kind of backlash, don't you think, against so-called feminists?
Yeah. Any other questions?
Yeah, just one footnote to Mrinal Pandey. I think Mrinal also had a bad days, and if I'm not mistaken, wrote a novel about it.
Yes.
You know, so it wasn't all hunky dory there. And the other thing, Sagarika, which you were talking about, you know, not focusing enough on gender and so on, and you said maybe that's changing. I'm not so sure it is. You know, what the two of you have been saying really applies to women professionally across the board. You know, certainly in India it does, and it's not so different globally as well. So maybe one should take what you were talking about a little further and actually, you know, try to focus on what you said were not sexy subjects, you know, education or gender or whatever. And
I think that is changing, because, you know, with the sort of increasing emphasis on gender justice, particularly after the Nirbhaya incident in Delhi, which really shook, I think, the entire nation. Somehow or the other, it became a kind of turning point, and it actually led to those protests and actually has now led to change in law. So the Criminal Law Amendment Act, as you know, has been changed after that case. There's now much more awareness, you know, but even on sexual harassment committees in offices, you know, Usha Rai is a veteran woman journalist, and she's, Usha Rai speaks of a time when she was in an office, when she started in the Times of India, and there was no ladies' toilet. There was no ladies' toilet in the entire building. From top to bottom, there was no ladies' toilet. So she had to go outside the office somewhere else, and, you know, the women were not supposed to go to the toilet. But so, you know, there have been women trailblazers who have, I think, worked and made the way a little easier for people like us, and whether it's an Usha Rai or a Bhumi Kapoor or a Dina Vakil or, you know, so many others, Neerja Chaudhary, for example, or Aarti Jera. I mean, there are so many, and they had to fight even harder than we had to. And, you know, and I'm so glad that, for example, sexual harassment is now getting much more attention than it is.
Yeah, I remember my first job interview was with a predator editor in the New Oberoi in Bombay, in his hotel room with the bed turned out. And he said, "Will you have something to drink?" And he was drinking a vodka. And then we were talking about music, and then I said something about liking Mukesh or something, and he started singing Mukesh songs. So I don't see that kind of thing happening now. I'm not saying sexual harassment doesn't exist, but, like, I mean, people are much more aware of their rights and, you know.
Yeah.
And
I think there are now, across the board, there are sexual harassment committees in most media offices.
Even as early as late as the 1980s, the Tribune newspaper never hired women, you know. So things have changed a lot. But as you said, it's an across industry scenario, you know. I mean, it's across the world, actually. But
and this kind of, you know, commodification and sort of re-sexualizing of the woman seems to be happening much more in a way now. There's a kind of backlash of sort of the male hatred for the woman. You know, it's a kind of almost like a backlash against, oh, you feminists and you assertive women and you all you people who are trying to come into our domain. So the hatred is even higher now. So you actually have to combat not only against the old stereotype, but the new hatred. And it's hatred. It's a straightforward, I would say, animosity. Which you have to challenge. It's tough.
You know, recently we had the film festival in Goa, and the National Network chose a very young girl who was a contract employee. She wasn't an employee, I'm sorry. She was on contract, and she was anchoring, and she fumbled in the way that she said, she called the governor of Goa, governor of India, and she obviously displayed a lack of knowledge. She was a very pretty girl, very inexperienced. And she was sacked, and not just that, just the way you face the trolls on social media, she did too. And she's devastated. How much damage has that done? You know, this pretty young thing becoming anchor, especially on TV. These very pretty girls who actually, you know, they actually live the male stereotype of how a woman should be. So pretty and so nice, and she's playing the perfect role of a woman. She'll do the anchoring of Sasto and Sazesh. And she'll do the anchoring of every film show. How much damage has that done?
See, this happens in all professions. I mean, this is the age of Twitter, you know. I mean, I don't think we can focus on one viral video. I think things have changed a lot since the 80s and since the early 90s when I joined journalism. And they're only going to change more. Of course, there are still stereotypes. I mean, there's still sort of, you're working with men on a power trip. But you, as a journalist, I mean, just the joy of being a journalist is sort of, you know, I mean, I think more than worrying about men and women, I worry about what's going to happen to Indian journalism, you know? I think the women will do as well as the men, and if they want to be editors, they will be editors. But of course, it'll take time for lots of women to be editors. But I think right now it's more like a crisis of Indian media.
As somebody from social media, my thing was, like for example, when the terrorist attack happened in Bombay, you know, the only content which was available was stuff which people were photographing and putting on social media. So one of my friends actually got picked up by CNN and BBC, and their media got picked up. So, you know, isn't it two parts? There's obviously a good and a bad side. Yeah. There are a lot of people who've been helping on social media. Another problem which I see is maybe that if you all were to build like fan clubs, because one problem with social media is obviously the negative elements are going to raise their head first. So you're going to have to create a positive element and a group of supporters. I mean, obviously they exist. It's not that they don't exist. It's just that maybe the approach to social media, because you can't ignore it today, right? So, I mean...
No, we are not saying that we don't love, we love social media.
Right.
But, I mean, even the killing of Osama bin Laden was reported on Twitter by one guy who was like two houses away or something, and he said, I can see something happening in my neighborhood and all, and that's how it started. So social media is super vital. I get lots of story ideas from social media. I've met so many interesting people through social media. My strategy with trolls is to just ignore, because I don't want anyone else also fighting with them on my behalf. Firstly, we don't even know who they are. I mean, I know who they are, but they choose to be anonymous, and if you ignore them, their tweets don't get any play. If you respond, then there's like, oh look, thousand people will retweet that. Sagarika is fighting with unknown Indian or whatever, you know? And that becomes the story of the day. So best to ignore, I think.
I think the other thing about, you know, is just to point out what Priya was saying and what you were saying about women across the board. I think what tends to happen in India is that, yes, there are obstacles to women. There are a lot of, obstacles to women advancing. But once they step out, you know, once they have the courage to actually come into the public domain and make their voices heard or come into the field, then slowly there is an acceptance. That is also there. It's not as if they're completely shunned for the rest of their life. Once they make that effort, and I think that is there. And I think, as Priya is saying, it's much more what's happening to the Indian media than what's happening just to women. I think Indian media, social media is a very important part of the Indian media. It's highly vital. It's a highly democratic technology. It breaks so many stories. So, I mean, I love Twitter. I love Facebook. I'm just upset there are these few elements who completely make it into something that it shouldn't be. It should be actually this incredibly democratic forum for open debate. But why should it be about name calling and threats of gang rape and threats of public stripping and, you know, all of that? Which is...
It happens to Michelle Obama also.
Yeah, it also happens to Michelle Obama.
It happens to everyone across the world. Yeah.
It happened to me after I finished my interview with Fidel Castro. I mean, all the Cubans in Miami had started calling me up at 2 in the morning and threatening to kill me, etc. So, you know, it's normal. But then it didn't help when my editor told me, don't stand very close to the subway, to the train when it's coming into the platform. That really scared the heck out of me.
I wanted to ask you to comment on what Rajmohan Gandhi said yesterday. He paid you and Raji a tremendous compliment. He said that they have preserved their self-respect and they have kept the spirit of the freedom of speech alive. So would you like to comment on that? How difficult has it been, and how do you see the future?
I'm not sure I really want to get into it in a major way, but I think let's meet over a drink.
Sorry.
Sagarika, you made an interesting parallel between women politicians and women journalists. The same problems they face, the aggression, and having acquired the hide of a rhinoceros. Like you said, I think the same qualities are needed for a politician. So would you think of actually, I mean, it's for both of you, making that crossover?
You know, Indian politics is incredibly hard. It's such a tough game. I mean, hats off to Jayalalitha, hats off to Mamata Banerjee, hats off to Mayawati. Honestly, I mean, they have literally clawed themselves up without being necessarily daughters and wives. And, you know, I mean, hats off to them, you know, because the criminalization of Indian politics is so widespread. It is such a tough, harsh, brutally patriarchal, brutally nasty. I mean, I think even good men get alienated, you know. Well-meaning men would find it difficult to survive. So for a woman to survive in Indian politics and get to the top, I think it's incredible. I mean, hats off to these women, you know, who do it. I have a lot of respect for all of them. For Mamata Banerjee, I have a lot of respect for her. I know that, you know, love her, hate her, but, you know, she's out there battling away. You know, so are the others. So it's incredible, actually, what they're able to do. Because it's very tough. As Priya said, journalism is tough enough. I mean, politics is just incredibly tough.
So definitely not.
Definitely not.
Should we just wrap up the session with a few closing points from our guests?
So I think, as Priya also said, all the women here, and don't be deterred. It is tough. It is difficult to be a woman journalist, but it's changing. The media is changing. The media is in a flux. A lot of important media is happening on the social media space. A lot of important journalism is happening in the independent space. A lot of important writing is happening in the independent space. So while, as I said, while corporatization, politicization, and sensationalization are the three evils of today's media, according to me, but there is a whole lot of independent space out there where you can get involved and you can challenge stereotypes. So the future is bright, even though at the moment it may not look that way, but it sure is.
And just to repeat my previous point, that I really feel that to change Indian journalism, women are going to be more important than they've ever been in this industry.
Big round of applause for our guests. Thank you again.